Hello, 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 and welcome to the RedLine Solutions Educational Webinar Series. I'd like to give a big thank you for everybody watching us on YouTube today, and our topic is PTI Leadership Council Update from the PMA Fresh Summit 2015. We're very excited to have three great speakers. We have Ed Tracy, the Vice President of Supply Chain Efficiencies with the PMA. We have Dan Vachet, the Vice President of Supply Chain Management with the United Fresh Produce Association. And we have our very own Todd Baggett, the CEO of RedLine Solutions. So without further ado, I will pass it on to Todd.
So with that, let's get into our agenda. I'll do a short RedLine intro, and then we'll get right into some of the topics that we reviewed at the PTI Leadership Council meeting that was held at the PMA in Atlanta a few weekends ago. That'll include some regulatory updates, some information about the GS1 food service initiative, as well as the GS1 retail initiative. And as Adrian said, we'll wrap it up with a little Q&A. So, you know, who's Redline? I'll make it real quick here because this is really kind of a public service webinar today to really get a lot of information out to folks who are interested in what's going on with traceability. Redline is a company. I started the company 18 years ago. We focus on inventory and traceability solutions. We offer the software and the hardware and the PTI labels, all of the different pieces that you're going to need, including the hardware maintenance, and the services. We do offer both on-premise applications, which would include our field solution, our packing solution, and our cooler solution, as well as a PC-based system called PTI Lite for small growers who are just trying to get their labeling and have basic traceability, as well as a new introduction, myproduce.com, which is a web-based inventory and traceability system. So, moving right ahead here, I'd like to go ahead and introduce Dan, who's going to walk us through the regulatory updates. Dan, over to you.
Thank you, Todd and Adrian. Appreciate your taking the time to let us explain what's going on as we came out of the PTI Leadership Council meeting that was held, as you mentioned, in Atlanta. And let's go to that next slide because, you know, sometimes people feel that there's a little FSMA fatigue because, quite honestly, this has been going on for quite some time. At least the acknowledgement that the Food Safety Modernization Act was exposed, and that was almost 5 years ago when President Obama signed that into law. Now, it's been a long time since we've opened that box to look at all of those rules and regulations for our food supply chain. And, you know, the emphasis on this was to ensure that our food supply is safe. I'd even go a step further and say safer, because we've had pretty darn good safe food. But, you know, in produce, as we know, on the fresh side, there is no kill step, and there's a risk in everything we do. But we're really focusing now, and I think it's the right thing to do, obviously, is rather than just responding to events that happen in our food supply chain, but make every effort to prevent it from the grower all the way through till it reaches the consumer. And the consumer obviously has some skin in this grain game, too, to make sure that their food is kept properly refrigerated after they purchase it from the store or the restaurant. Let's go to that next slide because in September, just this last September, they did release the preventative controls for human and animal food, which was a long time waiting. That is now being digested. Probably one of the bigger things that we like to see in there was that they changed that farm definition to have a wider definition. Because right now, before, if it was off-farm, it was under a different rule. But now, with the new definition of farm, as long as the facility, the packing facility, the handling facility, the majority ownership is by farms, it will be considered part of the farm. Many facilities may be miles away from the actual farm, but it's controlled by the growers, the farmers. So now that's going to be considered part of the farm, and the farms will now be covered under the produce safety rule, which was just released this last Monday. It's not made public yet because part of what they have to do before they release that to the public is make sure that literally all the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed. It's numbered correctly, because once this goes out for public consumption, it is part of legislation, and it takes legislation to make any changes. So it's very important that they get it right. We expect to see that perhaps by the end of this week, early next week. Our legal counsel has not been able to get a copy. Robert Gunther, our main lobbyist in Washington, D.C., is checking on this daily, and we've not seen daylight on it yet, but it will be released, and once it is, it will be gone over by numerous organizations to make sure that we understand the interpretation. So next slide, please. So when we get down to preventative controls for human food and animal food, what this really comes down to is that these covered facilities have to establish and implement the food safety system that really does, and most people have done this, they started to look at to analyze where the hazards are and the risk-based preventive controls. What that really means is going through your operations and understanding where there can be hazards and where there can be risk-based in your facility and the handling of the food product. So the rule sets those requirements for a written food safety plan that will include that hazard analysis, your preventative controls, and most importantly, the oversight and management of preventive controls. It really comes down to knowing what you're doing and say that, document it, and do it. You can't just put it away. This has got to start from the top down, and every day, everyone in the organization must be thinking about these rules and how they apply to avoid any product getting into commerce that may be compromised at any part of the handling process. So if we can go to the next slide, please. So on November 2nd, those rules, as I say, the produce safety, foreign supplier, and third-party accreditation rules have now been finalized and submitted for publication. Again, we're going back to that publication. It's going to take a few days before they release that as they go under review. But they are going to be made public very soon, according to the FDA, and when they do, as I mentioned, they will be gone over by numerous organizations and legal beagles to make sure that we interpret those correctly. And we look forward to that, being able to see those final rules, because when it originally started, when Obama signed it, it was about the 100,000 foot level with FSMA. FDA got into it, and they're bringing it down to the 50,000 foot level. But now we're going to get down, you know, closer to sea level, where we understand exactly what the industry is going to have to do under the FSMA rules. So we expect to see those within the next couple days, within a week at least, and when we see those published and start seeing comments on that. So when we go to the next slide on the Food Safety Monitors Action Produce Safety Rule, this is where the farms are going to come into play. And the goal there is obviously to strengthen that food safety by shifting the focus of preventing those food safety problems rather than responding to the problems after the fact. And that's what we're seeing in the press daily, or almost daily. A lot of meat recalls and that sort of thing may not make the press, but there are recalls. But we really want to get them to preventive stages in our fresh supply chain. Another change has been the revision of the water quality testing provisions. When they originally wrote this and released it, and we got the comment on it, they did not understand the different applications of water, what the sources of water are, whether it's groundwater, whether it's pumped out of the ground, whether it's surface water, how irrigation is done on various crops. If you take, you know, center pivots when you're doing potatoes, that's one way to irrigate and take care of the crop. There's drip irrigation. So again, there's so many different variables that one size is not going to fit all. So we're very happy that they're going to take that and the produce safety rule to account for those natural variations in irrigation and water sources. So. And then the other one was to adjust the approach on the manure and compost used in crop production because they needed to do additional research. We always need to make sure, and we do emphasize this, that it's got to be sound science when these rules are released and implemented So it can't just be written in a vacuum, so to speak, but it has to be real world and good sound science. So we can go to the next slide. The next one, the foreign supplier verification. The revisions were made to that to give importers more flexibility to determine the appropriate supplier verification measures based on the risk and the previous experience with their suppliers. So history is going to have some play into this, making it a little less difficult to do this, but nonetheless, there's still going to have to be audits, and the importer of record will be responsible to ensure that their supplier, their foreign supplier, is meeting the requirements that we expect here in our country. So it's a little bit of change, but it's going to be imperative that that importer understands and does have accurate knowledge of their supplier and the experience that they've had with them and based on that risk. So as we see our imports continue to increase, this is going to be more and more important, and the emphasis for those importers of record are very important to make sure that they understand this to protect our food supply with our imported products. The other additional one is a third-party accreditation. Now, FDA is going to recognize accreditation bodies, which will in turn be able to train the third-party auditors to conduct these food safety audits and issue certifications for the foreign facilities and food under specific programs. So, you know, there's still some gray areas because we haven't been able to go all the way through this, but as it's rolled out, there will be additional opportunities for you to learn how these rules are going to be implemented and the impact to our industry. So there will be continued education on this, and there are some times it's not going to happen if they release it next week. It's not going to be implemented the week after next, but we'll have some time, and there is a timeline out there. So if we can go to that next slide, this is kind of a good picture of how these rules are rolling out in the deadlines for the final rules when they're released, as we see there in the purple, and then according to the size of the operation, whether it's large, small, or very small. And the last one is water. As I mentioned, this is very critical to our industry, water usage wherever we are, but the fact that we have to make sure that these rules are right for the water supply, the testing that's got to be done, and that was some of the issues we had on the original release of these, was the type of testing and the frequency of testing, again, depending on that water source. So we're very happy that is stretched out. But you can see that for the small and very small operations, they are given additional time to make sure that they're in alignment with the FSMA rules, which, again, is critical. This is not to be damaging any part of our business, that everyone needs to participate, because as we always say, pathogens and those bad bugs don't just pick on large growers. They are willing to go anywhere at any time. So it's nice to see that we have a good timeline out there to implement these and get a full understanding of how we should go into them. So if we can go to that next slide. So what is next? So the final two rules will be due in 2016. Those are the sanitary transportation rules, which need to be released at the latest March 31st of 2016. Those have had many comments also. All of our organizations did have input on all of these. And then the intentional adulteration will be the final one there on May 31st of 2016. This will be critical for those folks that are handling food. If you're processing, say, a fresh cut processor, the ability to have intentional adulteration, there's just going to be some very specific things we have to do, or you have to look at your risk in your facilities to make sure that we eliminate the possibility of intentional adulteration throughout the supply chain. The last thing that will happen, and FSMA, as you probably understand, is a lot about record keeping. That rule will come out. Dates have yet to be determined, but that will include part of this traceability. as Ed and I and our counterparts have met with FDA, we've been very strong in the voice to make sure that they understand that our industry is actually does a very good job, but we wanted to help format this. And so basically what we're going to be looking for is what is in conjunction with the PTI. It's about record keeping. It's about having electronic records, being able to satisfy the inspectors when they come in if they suspect that there may be an issue with product that you either handled or passed through your facilities, that you have the proper record keeping, and we're really looking at those records for within 24 hours. We're tracking by the lot, which FDA is pleased that's the way we're going, and then have those electronics available within 24 hours. So rest assured that we're very confident that when the final rules are out, that the PTI program will be intact, because that is what we need to link the supply chain, as we all know is rather convoluted, and to link that in to satisfy these requirements. So if or when there is suspected food in the supply chain, we can remove it and make sure that our consumers understand that we have control of our processes. It's not a perfect world out there. There is the risk that this can happen, and it most likely will happen again. But to make sure we have confidence in our own systems to remove that food, identify it, number one, and be able to remove it from commerce so that we can maintain the strong markets we've developed to keep our healthy, fresh food available to everyone in the commerce. So the next slide and final slide, that's almost final slide, is when it's all done and said, again, I want to go back to that they do recognize, the FDA does recognize that there has to be a lot of training. So they're going to have a curriculum for qualified individuals. Right now, these two organizations up here, the Produce Safety Alliance and the Food Safety Preventive Controls Alliance, are two that are qualified. They're not really individuals, but they're organizations. What's going to have to happen is this is going to waterfall down. We've got to get the state agencies, the extension groups, the universities to be well-versed in this so they can help with the training and understanding of what the industry has to do. Will be trade associations, such as Ed's Association Produce Marketing and mine, the United Fresh, will be doing, making sure that we are available and doing training to understand those rules. We'll also have commodity groups that are involved, specific commodities. They want to make sure that they have the accurate and good training to make sure that this is implemented correctly. And then private sector consultants. There will be an ability to be qualified as a private sector consultant, again, to go in, but it's not going to be just say that you're qualified, but it's going to have to be through a recognized training course to make sure that everything is intact. So the next and final slide, I am getting to the final one, want to make sure that you're aware that both United Fresh and PMA, in partnership with several of the regional produce associations, are having free webinars that will help you understand the final rules. And that's really when they are released and we have the ability to understand them and the implications to your businesses. We want to be able to help you. We all want to be able to be in the same pool and swimming in the same direction. So this will also give everyone an opportunity to ask specific questions of the FDA subject matter experts. There was one held last month that was very well done and very well attended, and FDA is on the panel so that they can address questions from the participants. So as you can see, there's two webinars now being planned, both of them in December, December 11th and December 14th, and you can register for both of these through the PMA website. They are handling the registration for these, and the panel consists of the experts, not Ed and I. Ed and I are more supply chain, but the experts such as Dr. Gombas and Dr. Bob from PMA and Jim Gorney to be able to handle these and coordinate that with the FDA to make sure that our industry is well-versed and educated and answering the questions that are going to arise as these rules are released and finalized for implementation. So with that, I want to turn it over to, I often refer to Ed as my cousin, because we're in lockstep in all that we do in the field for PTI. And before I do that, because Ed is originally from Canada, but he now lives in the States and is with us in the U.S., but we have talked, and Jane Proctor from CPMA, Canadian Produce Marketing Association, is one of our partners in the PTI along with GS1. But Jane and Ron are very active with us in the PTI. And the Safe Food for Canadians Act is their version of FSMA. And one of the things that has occurred, of course, they just had a recent election, and everything was put on hold with their Safe Food for Canadians Act. But they expect to formalize the implementation to begin in 2016. They're going to move a little quicker than we are, and that's okay. And they're likely to be a little more prescriptive on traceability requirements. Jane spent a lot of time with them. Wording may be more prescriptive than what we're going to see, but nonetheless, it will be in lockstep from what we understand with what we are promoting for the implementation of the PTI. So again, they anticipate the requirements for electronic record transmission within 24 hours of request, the same as we have outlined with FDA. So the electronic records are going to be very important, and the traceability by the lot. So again, we're going to speak the common language between our trading partners in Canada. We both trade back and forth. They're one of our larger trading partners, as you're probably well aware. So we'll look forward when they do release that their form, which is the Safe Foods of Canadians Act, in our FSMA. It will be fairly close in alignment, and that's what we've all worked for with our Canadian friends. So with that, Ed, if you want to add anything from the Canadian side, please be my guest as I turn the speaking arrangements over to you.
No, thanks, Dan. That was a very good regulatory update. The only thing I can say is Dan and I work with Jane's Industry and Technology Advisory Committee, and when the Canadians do release their regulations on traceability, it is anticipated that the retailers are going to move forward in Canada with implementing their requirements. They're starting to get aligned, and looks like they're going to go down that direction. I'm not sure they're going to have a choice after the regulations come out, but we know that the Canadian retailers have been a little slow in participating and requiring, but we're expecting that to change as well. I'm going to talk to you about a couple of initiatives that do touch on traceability that have been going on. The GS1 U.S. Food Service Standards Initiative, which was originally created around 2009. And then I'll touch on the GS1 U.S. Retail Grocery Initiative, which was, I think it was kicked off late last year, early this year. So on the food service side, their initiative has been focused on in three main areas, and you will notice that both initiatives are similar, but they do have their differences. They are focused on increasing efficiencies, enhancing food safety and traceability, and then improving product information. And what we've seen, you know, they're up to 127 companies. They started in 2009 with 55, so the momentum is growing over there. And what we're seeing is their initial focus was on product information, nutritional information, allergen information. So they kind of focused on that piece at first. And then we're now seeing them move down the path into food safety and traceability, labeling on cases, and moving into the traceability area. For those of you who want more information on there's a couple of webinars that GS1 US is hosting. There's a link for it. Just go onto the GS1 US website and you can pick that up, and they'll explain the whole initiative, what it's about, and if you're not part of it, service the food service trade, I suggest you at least pay attention to what's going on and join that webinar. And on the next slide, you're going to see there are a number of directives now, initiatives by food service operators requiring labeling. They were focused on doing GDSN and data synchronization up till now, from 2010 till now. they've not, other than Subway and Wendy's, they've not made it a mandatory requirement with a firm date of when you need to synchronize all your items, but all of the companies have been focused on that. What I'm showing you here with these dates, these are mandates or requirements supply, you know, of the suppliers of these organizations. Arby's and Chipotle and Dine Equity, Domino's and have dates out there now, as well as Yum Brands. Yum Brands is what the first one to go, requiring case labeling with dynamic information. So not just the barcoded GTIN on there. They want the lot and in some cases used by date. And it's beyond all fresh. It's all products going into these operations. So everything from their napkins to their watermelons to their produce to meat, dairy, everything, they want everything labeled with a GS1 128 label. PTI labeling will satisfy all their requirements. And what we have found is occasionally some of them have gone out with the standard GS1 requirement, and the guidance document of GS1 requires two labels per case. If you get that from one of these operators, please involve either GS1 or Dan or myself. We were able to convince everyone who's gone out with misinformation, if you will, that PTI requirement is one label per case. That will satisfy everybody. Sometimes they just issue standard text from the guidance documents, but they all understand how the produce industry works, and every one of them will accept PTI. So out of all of their labeling requirements, the PTI, the standard PTI label will satisfy every one of them. And there are some more operators working on this, and they're going to be leveraging the case labeling through their operations in their stores. Yum Brands have integrated into their inventory management process where they're able to scan the cases when they come into the back of the store, and then when they go out of the cooler into the prep area, they scan them again, and they tie that into their inventory management system. And others are doing similar things. So it's exciting to see now that they're finally getting caught up to PTI and in some cases may surpass the retail side on implementing case labeling. On the next slide, you're going to see the retail initiative. Slightly different areas of focus: supply chain visibility, product information and images, and then operational efficiencies. And this is fairly new. The three working groups are just getting, figuring out what they're going to do and prioritizing and laying out roadmaps for that. 50 companies have signed on so far, which is a pretty good start. Some very big companies, as you can imagine, on that, both from the retail side and from the supply side. And again, there's a couple webinars coming up hosted by GS1 for people to learn more about that. And again, if you're supplying the retail trade, I suggest a minimum you attend one of these webinars so you can understand what's going to be coming at you. They're going to be including everything from barcodes to case labeling and EDI and GDSN. The three work groups, product information and images, they're right now defining what are the required and optional attributes for exchanging master item data through the global data synchronization network. So they're working their way through that right now. The second group, supply chain visibility, they're developing a process flow. I think we just finalized that, and that's going to be the foundation. And it's really of here's all the processes that are supported by GS1 standards and how the supply chain could work. Again, these are for all categories in retail, retail grocery, not just fresh or fresh produce, but we are definitely part of it. They're prioritizing their implementation plans. We're trying to create a roadmap, if you will, with some milestone dates. And that's around increased product labeling and location identification. So the other two areas that they're kind of focusing on, which is completely aligned with PTI. I'm actually participate on that work group to make sure that what we've done in PTI is being recognized, supported, and it is amongst the work group. And we want, you know, more visibility or increased visibility for traceability purposes and for on-shelf availability. They're the two benefits that we're looking at getting out of it. And so far, we're starting to gain some traction, which is good, so stay tuned. Then on the operational efficiencies, they're looking at, you know, what GS1 tools and processes can be put in place to increase efficiency within the supply chain. And one of the first areas they're looking at is advanced ship notices, and then identifying which attributes should be included in the advanced ship notice transmission. For those of you who don't know what an ASN is, think of it as like electronic bill of lading. So they're trying to identify what bits of information should be in that electronic transmission. PTI has gone ahead, and we actually have defined for PTI the ASN with all the attributes, and that is being used as a basis for them to work from, which will apply to most of the fresh categories, and not so much on you know, probably a few less on the dry grocery side and the general merchandise. And as far as the next slide on the retailers update, because anytime we get together with the PTI Leadership Council, everybody is waiting for retailers to implement. We do know that, you know, Walmart have implemented and have talked quite frankly about the benefits they're receiving from implementing standardized case labeling on all their cases, RPCs and cardboard and corrugate. Mike Agostini at Dan's United Fresh Show last summer talked about how they're getting operational efficiencies and the marked improvement in reducing their shrink at retail by having standardized case labels. This time, in Atlanta, we had Whole Foods, Matt Rogers, come and talk to the group and talk to us about how they're leveraging the PTI labeling. And it's quite innovative, and I'm more kudos to them for figuring this out. What they've done is they started a program in with their fresh meat, identifying to the consumer at point of sale information about the person or the company that supplied this product. And they call it a good, better, best, or unrated. They have four categories that they'll actually put a little sticker at the point of sale, you know, so the consumers, when they're buying that particular product, they know the rating of the supplier. And it's the suppliers have to go onto a portal to enter information about their company, which includes information on their food safety practices, traceability, fair work practices, social responsibility, sustainability, and there's 40-odd questions they have to answer. When they finish entering the information, it gives them the rating for their company, so they know if they get a better rating, what categories or what questions they need to, you know, what areas they need to focus on in order to get their rating up to a best. If a company has not entered their information, then they come up as unrated. They have over 800 suppliers registered and all their majors. They said they have 30,000 plus GTINs registered, and over 50% of their inbound produce is labeled. And how the program works is they enter their information. They also enter all the GTINs that they may ship to Whole Foods and require PTI labeling. They want the RPC label on all the products. And the clerk who's merchandising that particular case of produce, what they're doing is they're scanning the PTI label. It looks up to this portal through an RF gun and pulls down the rating, because the ratings can change for each supplier as they, you know, improve their operations. It pulls down the current rating. Then they put a sticker at the point of sale, and they communicate to their consumers information about the supplier. Ingenious use of traceability, and he said they get traceability almost as a side benefit from this entire program. So they're leveraging PTI for an improvement process within their company. Matt also discussed that they're getting other operational improvements by having consistent case labeling on every case. and he didn't get into too many details on it, but he did say that they're having other operational improvements beyond this program as a result of having consistent PTI labeling. Other retailers in the room on the leadership council were very consistent, saying when the record-keeping regulation is released, then they are going to go forward with their PTI requirements of their supply base, that they just want to make sure, and until we see what those regulations look like, they want to make sure that it's consistent with what their thinking is. They've, you know, a number of them have already gone through a number of pilots, they know what needs to be done to support it, and they're just waiting to pull the trigger. I do know others are working on it, and having been a former retailer responsible for the distribution operations in major retailers, it's a lot of work for them to implement this. It's not easy. They have thousands of people to train. They have all sorts of systems to update, and I know a lot of them are working on it and working their way through it. They're seeing the benefits. They're hearing the benefits from Walmarts and Whole Foods and Publix and other companies who've implemented, and they all want to get up to their level of expertise. It's just a lot of work for them to do. And I think with that, Todd, I'm going to turn it back to you for questions.
Great. Thank you, Ed. And, you know, really what I noticed kind of going through some of the GS1 initiatives, particularly the retail one, is they're kind of back where the PTI was when we got started in the 2008 and on period. I remember clearly, you know, working with Dan and yourself and others on our own definition of what our ASNs needed to look like and what those attributes are. So it's good to see that going through, and it's also good to let everyone understand that, you know, while we've been focused on our industry produce, that the bigger picture is that FSMA is not something that's tied to specifically produce or fresh. It's going to be across the board for all food products, which really is raising the game of our food safety across North America with both the U.S. and the Canadian initiatives and legal acts that are going to be going into place here. So with this, we are to our Q&A part. As Adrian had mentioned in the beginning, there's a box that says questions. You can see it here with the big red arrow pointing to it. If you haven't entered a question and you have one, go ahead and enter it now. Adrian, do we have any questions so far?
Yes, we've got a couple of questions here. What does the FDA consider to be a small farm? I'll just open that to the group, whoever wants to jump in.
I'll jump on that one. You know, the small farm is identified as averaging less than $1 million in sales per year for the sale of human food. So it's changed a little bit. It used to be 500. Now they raise it to a million to consider you to be a very small business. There's going to be records required to support that, 3 years records to support your status as a very small business.
Thank you. So another one here. What do you make of the Chipotle E. coli scare going on in the Northwest, and could the PTI have prevented this?
I'll take the first half. Since I live outside of Seattle, Ed, I'll just make one comment and turn it over to you. This has been very interesting from a local standpoint here in the state of Washington and Oregon, where they have literally closed stores because of this. You know, the challenge that we have, continuing to challenge, is to identify the product that may be causing these issues. And unfortunately, they haven't even identified the product. They keep whittling it down. From what I read today, they're just pointing at produce, but they do not know what produce it is. But the fact where PTI will come in, when they do recognize what commodity it is, with someone like Chipotle, they do have a system in place that they can track and trace that and remove it from commerce. So, Ed, I'll let you chime in on that also.
Yeah, and you know, just so people are clear, PTI will not prevent foodborne illnesses. That's FSMA and regulations and other things that cover that. PTI is designed when there is a foodborne illness identified in pulling the product out of the supply chain a lot quicker than we've been able to do in the past. It may, assist in the epidemiology where they're trying to figure out, okay, what product caused this? And because I know when we did the pilots with FDA a couple of years ago, one of the scenarios we did was a fully PTI compliant supply chain, and we were able to do the trace back, trace forward well within 24 hours because we had all the electronic records and submitted them and were able to identify the source and where the product went up and down the supply chain. So, could it assist with the epidemiology? Perhaps, and I think it could. If everybody, if they were able to get all the records of every shipment gone into every Chipotle store, all the way back to the source of where it came from, where the originating farm was, then I think they would probably see a point of convergence. It may assist them in defining, in identifying commonalities across all of their restaurants with people who are affected. Will it for sure? Don't know. But definitely, once they do identify what the product is that is making people sick, if they're 100% PTI compliant, pulling that back out of the supply chain and being able to trace it back to the source and then from the source back out again to see who else got the product, PTI would definitely assist and speed up that process.
Ed, you're spot on, Ed, because it's really so much centered around the record keeping is what we've referred to before. When we have those records intact and they do identify something, the ability to quickly identify it and trace it back through our convoluted supply chain. So spot on, Ed.
This, Todd, I had one more thing I'd like to add to that, and that is just, first of all, hats off to Chipotle for the way they're handling this because they've been very proactive. They didn't need to close all those stores. They did it proactively because they knew they didn't know what the exact source was, and they're protecting their customers. So I respect them for that. Furthermore, I would say, I like Chipotle. They actually did a presentation to our PTI Leadership Council last June when we were in Chicago, and what I really got from them was that they are tracing all of the items, and the challenge I'm sure they're having right now is that when you get a burrito, you don't just have one thing on it. It's not just meat, it's not just cheese, it's not just lettuce. You may have a combination, so they've got to go through and figure out of the people who've been identified that have been sickened, what specifically did they order, and trying to correlate those. And I'm sure they're already in the process of identifying all the suppliers of all the components that were there because they do have a traceability system. And I think if anything, it's helped reduce the scope of this event. So although it's a difficult situation for them, I think that as a company and as a consumer, I have a lot of respect for what they've done and how they've handled this whole outbreak. So go ahead, Adrian, any more questions?
Good. So what do we know about FDA's plans to educate growers on how to move forward to meet their timelines?
Well, I think that was probably covered under how they want to go about getting folks accredited to do this so that they have recognized the bodies that can be third party. FDA is going to spend a lot of time out front. But, they are limited in manpower. They need help. So they're really going to start doing train the trainers so that they can get out and educate as many people and have this spread throughout the country. And they're going to work very diligently on that. They're always asking for more money. They don't get it. So, again, they don't have all the qualified folks that they need, but they are going to go out and to the private sector and using universities, using regional associations to get someone up to speed so that there is the opportunity for everyone to be knowledgeable about what they do to make sure that they're implementing correctly. So it's not going to happen overnight, but you'll see it start to roll out and you'll start to see folks that are accredited and make sure that they are if you're going to engage with someone. But they will make every effort, and they will be having these webinars, and I mentioned there's a couple in December that you can start asking the right questions for them and ask those questions the FDA themselves. So, but they're going to be very diligent in this. They know it's a big responsibility to get this right and get from the grower on up recognizing what it is they need to do to be compliant with the FSMA rules.
Yeah, and Dan, I'd like to add to that. The other thing they're also going to be coming out with are guidance documents. So So the regulation comes out, and then after that, there's guidance documents which really interpret, say, okay, if you're this type, here's what you need to do, here's what you don't need to do. So they are working on those, and in the webinars that Dan mentioned, they reference those guidance documents and which ones they're working on. So still more to come from them.
So we've got one here. Will the written food safety plans covered under the preventative controls need to be submitted to the FDA for approval?
My understanding is you won't have to submit them to the FDA for approval, but you're going to have to make sure that you are have an audit that shows that you are in line with FSMA. But I have not heard that you're going to have to submit them to FDA. They would be inundated with that, but I think it's going to be as you qualify yourself and have an audit done with an accredited body and an audit, then that's when you're going to have the records. But I don't believe, unless you've heard something different, Ed, that you're going to be required to turn them into FDA.
Now, where you're going to have it is when they inspect your facility. They are required to inspect at a different frequency in small and large operations. So when the inspector comes knocking on your door, one of the FDA or a state employee acting on behalf of the FDA, when they're inspecting your facility, you better have all your ducks in a row and your paperwork there and your plan fully documented, because that's when the test will be.
Yeah, and that's a very important point, and as I mentioned too, this is a type of exercise. It's not just an exercise. It's critical that it starts from the top down in an organization, because you just can't write down your procedures and your practices and put them on the shelf. You've got to be practicing them every single day. So again, it's from the top down, and training and retraining if it's required, because when you do get that audit, they'll be looking at the records, and they'll be obviously still talking to individuals in the process that they understand what their requirements are. So it'll be forthcoming in those audits.
Okay, so we've got one here. The Whole Foods program is interesting. Did they talk about any advantages they were seeing from using the PTI?
Yeah, I think I covered that, but he didn't specifically go into the other supply chain advantages that they're getting. It is the underpinning of the Good, Better, Best program, because that's how they're able to communicate that to the store clerk to label the shelf properly. But I suspect, since they've required what we're calling the RPC label, the one with the pack date on it, that they're getting improved rotation from the back room of the store out to the store floor, because if every case has the pack date on it in a standardized format, then you're going to be rotating the stock out properly in the proper sequence. Prior to that, it may have been on there, but in the lot number is in some kind of a format that was only known to the supplier and wasn't very helpful for the retail clerks. The other thing I do know that they are rolling out, they've got their major suppliers done. They've got well over half of the cases labeled. And what Matt talked about was they're now doing phase two, which is the local and regional suppliers. So they've got a roadshow coming up in all different locations across the U.S. That they're going to, and actually 11 and one in Canada, they're going to be doing a roadshow talking to their local and regional produce suppliers about, they need to get on this program. They need to be labeling their cases. They need to be PTI compliant, and they need to go on the portal and fill out all the other information. And my understanding, they're going to be fairly aggressive on the requirements with the remaining suppliers that haven't complied with them yet.
Okay, so there's one here. Looking at Dan's slide and the timelines, it looks like large companies will have to be compliant with preventative controls for human and animal food by the end of 2016 and produce safety rules by 2017. Is that correct?
That is absolutely correct. Yeah, they have that's the timeline that they've put out there. And so, yes, the chart that I had on the screen is accurate, yes.
Okay. And who does the foreign supply verification program focus on, and is it something that growers need to be concerned about?
Well, from the perspective that it's foreign suppliers, so if you're an importer, that's who needs to be concerned about this and recognize their responsibility in that. So it is no domestic growers, if that was the reference on that question, but the foreign grower is going to have to be scrutinized by that importer. Again, they have a working relationship, but they're going to have to make sure that they are up to the standards, and it's going to be incumbent upon the importer of record to ensure that. And there will be inspections made on those foreign facilities and the suppliers. So, but from the standpoint of who's responsible for that product when it reaches our shores and comes in through the ports, it's going to be the importer of record. But the growers themselves, foreign growers, are going to have to abide by the same rules that our growers are.
Okay, and so it says that Ed showed a slide on food service operators implementing traceability programs with case labeling requirements. Are these labels the same as PTI labels?
Yes, for produce. So the PTI label will satisfy, and the standard label, or what we're deeming as the RPC label with the barcode on the top and the pack date and human readable only, will satisfy all of the operators. And if you get, if you're a supplier and you get a requirement that's counter to that or requiring more than the standard PTI label, and I know some suppliers aren't comfortable pushing back with their customers, Dan and I can assist you in that. We've had 100% success rate where others have issued directives. But they issue one directive for all products, not knowing or not realizing that produce is a little bit different. Produce does not go across conveyor belts in the retail, in the distribution channel from the time it leaves a packing house. And some of those regulations or requirements are designed around, you know, general merchandise going down a case of serviettes going down a conveyor line, where you want two labels on the case. So if you do get any requirements that are counter to PTI, let us know and we'll help you educate the operator.
And that's a great point, Ed, because a lot of times who may be asking for this additional information may have just been told by a different department that's what they want to do, and they really don't understand the requirements. So it's always good to verify. As Ed said, a lot of folks on the sales desk don't want to question their customer. So let us do that. We're happy to do that and make sure that everyone understands the requirements and how these programs are rolling out.
Okay, we've got one here. On the retail initiative, I saw traceability listed. Why are there not more retailers using PTI today?
Two words, it's hard. It's a lot of work, and there's a lot of them working on it and trying to figure out where the benefit is, and you know, the way it's going to work for a retailer is if they are able to accept an advanced ship notice with all the case level information by pallet. That's not easy to implement if you've not done it, and it is even more difficult to implement it in produce because our industry is fluid and dynamic. We're not shipping tomato soup from one factory where it always comes from the same factory and you know exactly what the GTN is going to be. Our business is a little more fluid than that. There's a number of suppliers. The systems in produce for retailers' distribution centers is typically not as rigid as the rest of the products in there because we are bought and sold and traded as a commodity. So it's difficult for them to do the changes in the programming and setting up their operations to take advantage of PTI. They all want it. I've met with the Fresh Executive Council of FMI, which are the heads of Fresh, all Fresh, not just produce, for all the major retailers that are FMI members, which is all the major retailers, and they all want to get there. They're all at various stages of implementation, but it is definitely a conversation at the boardroom table, especially since, you know, first time in our history of our industry that with the Jensen Farms cantaloupe recall, which unfortunately took the lives of over 30 people, and two major retailers had to settle lawsuits in the seven and eight figure range, that really got the attention of every CEO of every retail grocery chain out there saying, okay, what are we doing about it? So that really woke them up. They've been looking at it, working on it. It's not as easy as implementing it in one operation. You know, Kroger have over 50 produce DCs, and so trying to rally that and implement that across their network. You know, Safeway and Albertsons going through their merger. They've got a lot of system challenges trying to get everybody on a single platform, but there is definitely something that I've not heard one retailer that's not working on it. They're all just at various different stages of implementation.
Yeah, and that's so true, Ed. You know, with the mergers and acquisitions that have gone on, the large retailers has been a challenge. And many of their IT guys are applauding this because they do get to make adjustments to the systems, but it's very, very a large undertaking, and they need to get, you know, they have to do their fair share and do the heavy lifting from a financial standpoint to justify all of this. They all understand it's the right thing to do, but it's not happening as quickly. That's why I always applaud the supply side who came to the table. Many of you are at the table and are compliant with PTI, and hopefully, as we've seen, you get some efficiencies internally just by identifying what you need to do to be PTI compliant. So, but the retail side is slow to come to the table. They recognize they're going to have to, and as Ed pointed out, they've got some risk management issues that they're dealing with too. So we're all in this swimming pool together and need to be going in the same direction. So it will happen. It's just a matter of time.
So that's us out of time today. We greatly appreciate listening in to our event. You can see more at the redlineforproduce.com site, and we look forward to seeing you soon at the next Redline Educational Webinar. Be well and be safe.